Hello to whoever is listening. Over the Garden Wall is one of my favorite cartoon shows ever, and has a lot of depth on the surface. But this is an iceberg, and if you have no clue who the chap talking to you is, hey, I'm Dr. Skipper, and this is the Over the Garden Wall iceberg. An iceberg is a chart of the most known to least known stuff, and I recommend you watch this video while doing productive activities like wasting the summer playing video games, drawing art, building Lego, or anything that could help pass the time. Also, if you're interested, there's other iceberg videos on my channel. I have a playlist and you could watch all of them there. Also, I have a playlist for all my other main content stuff if you want to go look at that as well. Also, if you enjoy the video, a like and a subscription would help too. But I recommend you get to the end of the video, then make your mind up then. Also, thank you to The Hole in My Garden for helping with the script of this video. With that though, I'll start. Elijah Wood. So this name, Elijah Wood, you probably know it because of Lord of the Rings, which is pretty surprising that he did a cartoon animation series. But to those who don't know him, I'll explain it now. Like I said, this name's pretty recognizable to people who watched Lord of the Rings growing up. So Elijah Wood is a 40-year-old American actor most well known for his role as Frodo Baggins in the Lord of the Rings series. He's also been in other stuff, but you know, because of this topic, he's also played Wurt in the show. As for why he chose the role, I'll just let him speak for himself here.
And then the artwork, and it was really, honestly, the artwork that kind of drew me in. It sort of, it evoked, you know, cartoons that we haven't seen in a long time, the idea of something that's hand-painted, 2D cell animation. It was sort of like this idea of taking something from the old world and bringing it into people's living rooms now.
Elijah seemed to have a genuine dedication and appreciation for the artistry of the show, and was incredibly dedicated to deliver upon Mikhail's vision. With that though, we should transition to who Mikhail is. Mikhail worked on Adventure Time. Patrick Mikhail. I'm not gonna write his biography, but I'll tell you what he is. He's an American storyboard artist, a writer, animator, songwriter, filmmaker, and just a jack of all trades. He's also the creator of Over the Garden Wall. So after Mikhail's graduation from Cal Arts and following his departure of Flapjack as a writer and storyboard artist, he joined a new team, where he helped develop the pilot in the series for Adventure Time. Once it was picked up by Cartoon Network, Patrick continued to work on the series as the show's creative director through season 2. He also did freelance on the show as a songwriter, as well as providing the occasional bit of creative counsel, which lasted until season 5. Tomb of the Unknown. This was a project taken up by Mikhail following his departure from Adventure Time, which was mentioned in the last topic. But if you expect these topics to flow into one another like they have thus far, I got some bad news for you, because it's just not gonna happen. Getting back to the topic, however, Tomb of the Unknown is a 2013 short film created by Patrick Mikhail, and is essentially the pilot for Over the Garden Wall. That being said though, Tomb of the Unknown differs from Over the Garden Wall in many key aspects. Most notably would be the overarching plot. Tomb of the Unknown is about Wurt and Greg seeking to find the pilot's namesake, an ancient tomb that is said to contain everything that is forgotten. Whereas Over the Garden Wall is about two boys trying to find a way home while avoiding the evil influence of the beast, which is a complete non-presence in Tomb of the Unknown. There's also a few changes in the art style and voice actors, such as Beatrice, who is voiced by Natasha Legro, and not Melanie Linsky, but it still has voice actors like Elijah Wood and Colin Dean, and the soundtrack is still composed by The Blasting Company. Tomb of the Unknown though, when watching it, it's actually pretty good. I recommend you find it. You can watch the whole version on YouTube. It's still enjoyable. It's weird though to see the difference of budget from the animation since it got picked up, but you'll still have a good time and you'll probably enjoy it. Different frog names. Throughout the show, Greg's frog, the brother's frogs, because you know, Greg wouldn't want that, is called many things, which I'll go through now. Kitty, Wurt, Wurt Jr., George Washington, Mr. President, Benjamin Franklin, Dr. Cucumber, Greg Jr., Doctor, Skipper, woohoo, that's me, and also Ronald. Also included in the comic book series, there's Jonathan Livingston Applesauce, Private Applesauce, and Johnny. And then finally and conclusively, Jason Funderburger. I think I speak for everyone here when I say my favorite name is Skipper, but you know, might be a little biased with that, so if you disagree with me, I don't care. But please leave your favorite name in the comments and we could all point and laugh at how wrong you are because Skipper's awesome. But okay, that was the first layer. But now, like the layers of hell in Dante's Inferno, we're just gonna keep going down and down. So let's check out the second layer now. Episode 9 is a canonical beginning. Throughout the whole series, we are led to believe that the show is set within some old 18th century setting, and that Wurt and Greg are some old town pilgrim people. Episode 9 is a flashback that recontextualizes the entire series by showing Wurt and Greg's old-timey outfits, but they're actually just Halloween costumes, as well as revealing the morbid event and petty buildup of the brothers' arrival to the unknown, which places the episode chronologically at the beginning of the series. Another neat tidbit about this topic before we move on, according to the audio commentary during production and editing, the episode was originally intended to be an opening of the series, but was moved to a later point as Mikhail felt as though the context made the unknown and a story as a whole lack its intrigue. It would be harder for the audience to be invested in as they would have the belief it was all some kind of dream and therefore is just inconsequential. Potatoes and Molasses. Unsure if this is simply referring to the songs or perhaps something else, but I'm gonna be working off of some assumption that this is referencing perhaps the most catchy song in Over the Garden Wall soundtrack, which I'm not gonna be playing in this video, because if you play the song, it for some reason gets blocked in North Korea, which is kind of funny. I don't know why Kim Jong just doesn't like potatoes and molasses. He's probably more of a syrup fan, but sucks to suck. So Potatoes and Molasses is the ninth song on the soundtrack and is sung by Greg's voice actor, Colin Dean, and first appeared in the third episode, Schooltown Follies. The song was said to be based off Shirley Temple's song, Animal Crackers in My Soup, which could be seen in the general melody and tune, and was later reprised in a Latin rendition called Potatus et Molasses, which in contrast to the latter is much more somber and foreboding, being associated with the beast in his song, Come Wayward Souls. But go listen to both versions of the song. They're both incredible songs and are synonyms with the series as a whole. Celebrity voices. Most of Over the Garden Wall's mainstream attention was geared towards the voice actors. Somehow, Mikhail and his team managed to acquire a bunch for the series. The most familiar names being, of course, the obvious, you know, Elijah Wood, as I said in the first layer. And some other people like Christopher Lloyd, John Cleese, Ting Curry, Chris Isaac, and Jack Jones. But I'm actually interested in what's your favorite voice actor in the show, if you have watched the show, that is. Please comment down below. My assumption is there's gonna be a bunch of Greg and I agree. I like Greg and Wart a lot. For Sarah. Those who have watched the show would perhaps remember Wart making a tape for his crush Sarah, which he ends up accidentally giving to her. What you might not know, however, is that the tape is actually a real piece of merchandise of the show, which was made by Cartoon Network as promotional material in partnership with a company called Mondo. If you have a devout near cult-like obsession with the show, then I presume most of the fanbase knows about this. And you might remember this line, there's clarinet and poetry on that tape. Yes sir, this tape does feature some poems read by Frodo himself, and it's interspersed with little clarinet solos by the composers of the show's soundtrack, Blasting Company. If you'd like to give this a listen, the whole thing's on YouTube, so follow the link I might leave in the description. If you want to hear Wart wooing you with stanzas upon stanzas of Elijah Wood waxing philosophical through your cassette player. If you're after a physical copy though, I can't help you there. Unfortunately, the official site doesn't seem to have a copy, and it seems unlikely it'll ever be restocked. Even though I don't own a cassette player, it'd still be pretty cool to own one. You know, just for a merchandise standpoint, it is a collectible. You could probably find it resold though somewhere. I know. I don't want to say eBay because you might get scammed, but Halloween. So like the runtime of the series, this part's going to be short. Over the Garden Wall is seen as a perfect Halloween miniseries, which is why I'm going to regret posting this video in June. The reason why the show is liked so much is because it's a moody October aesthetic. It also has such a nice gritty atmosphere, talking pumpkins possessed by walking corpses. It's such a good spooky miniseries for the time. Also, as I mentioned earlier, the show literally takes place on Halloween. Every time October comes and it starts to get cold, I just really like rewatching the series. Kind of makes me feel like a kid again, so it's so fun to watch this during, you know, the spooky month. But alright, that was the second layer. And if we're still going on by the Dante Inferno logic, I guess we're all moving into gluttony, which is fitting because, you know, like a fat guy eating Halloween candy, this layer is stuffed with trivia and, you know, short theories and stuff. So this one's probably going to go on for longer, so stick with me folks. Greg is Mikhail's son. Not too much on this one. Essentially, in an old interview, Patrick Mikhail said that Greg's character is loosely based off his real life son. Like I said, this is a bit reaching, because I think with Greg, you could probably find Greg in everybody. I mean, I mentioned it in my video, which you could go find in the description, but my whole point about Greg is that Greg is the entitlement of innocence. You know, Wirt is seen as a pessimistic teenager, where Greg is a naive child. Anybody with children, and just children in general, are super naive, so you could of course make that connection with anybody. American folklore references. Over the Garden Wall, by the admission of talent working on it, takes heavy design and story influence from classic Americana, seen most notably in the show's reference to old American folklore. Pottsville, for example, is just a, you know, a reference to old American traditions of Halloween. I'm gonna nail a hammer in my head the amount of times I've mentioned this holiday so far. If you like Halloween, tell me. There's also a lot of influences taken from old pieces of Americana. Literature by the Brothers Grimm as well as Lewis Carroll, chromolithography and some Native American influence all over the examples of Americana. They're utilized pretty well in Over the Garden Wall. Like I said, I'm aware most of these just aren't folklore, but the show's a bit dense with intellectual references and historical callbacks, and it's hard to stay focused on that given topic. Fred belonged to the Highwayman. Within the show, there's no indication of this aside from Fred being hitched outside the tavern. Him belonging to the Highwayman is instead confirmed in Over the Garden Wall's comics. And, well, I don't own a copy of this comic, so I'm gonna admit laziness for this part and just read off the Over the Garden Wall wiki. The Highwayman first came across Fred the Horse when he robbed a carriage driver on St. Leonard's Bridge, and the horse followed the driver inside the covered bridge. The Highwayman threatened Fred into giving him the load he'd been pulling down the river. He also made Fred promise to not tell anyone what he'd seen. Later, after Fred had been forced to tell a judge that the Highwayman had stolen his load, Fred returned to St. Leonard's Bridge. Fred felt someone on his back, and it was the Highwayman. Since Fred has told others what happened, the Highwayman took Fred as his horse, forcing him to become an outlaw like himself. I mean, yeah, I didn't really know about this until researching it. That's pretty cool. I like how the Highwayman dances. There's not much to, you know, say more about that. I'll move on. Beatrice's dog in episode 1. Later in the same episode, when Wirt and Greg get Edelwood oil out of the dog, it later becomes the dog that we see in the opening and at the end of the series. We had the same dog in the ending montage. Just a cute little doggo, isn't it? The old mill belongs to Beatrice's family. We see the old mill several times throughout the show. When the woodsman brings Wirt and Greg to the mill, he says that he found it abandoned and repurposed it upon finding it empty. The mill is decorated with several things resembling bluebirds, and Beatrice herself was nearby the mill during the episode, as are Beatrice's family as they're revealed in the final to be, you know, bluebirds. The ending confirms that Beatrice and her family resided there following the ending, but the clues I pointed out heavily support the interpretation that the mill belongs to Beatrice's family. The unknown was not a dream. So when it comes to the unknown, it was believed that it was a dream because they fall into the river and then they wake up in the hospital. But there's a lot of evidence to prove this is not true, by the frog glowing up or just anything. I think the unknown was not a dream either. I think the unknown has to do with the afterlife, and you could watch my video about this too. But with that, I'm going to be moving on now to the fourth layer, Clarence Universe. In the final episode where Wirt and Greg return to their hometown, you could see a sky view of their city, with of course a few key edits. The city in Over the Garden Wall takes place during night and has got a big fat hospital. You tend to see this a lot in animated shows that are, you know, in the same production company. It saves a lot of money, you know, to just reuse something that you've got in archive instead of paying some artist to make, you know, something new from scratch. It is still technically a bit of a reach, but nah, so be it. Wirt's costume. So Wirt's costume is intentionally made to not be of anything particular, as an indication of his character that's somehow, you know, unsure of himself and drenched in insecurity. Metaphor aside, Wirt's costume is just basic jeans and shirts, with some suspenders for that old-timey pilgrim feel. Also, the hat's just a Santa hat. You see this in the episode itself, with the white stuff cut off and a jacket used by one of Wirt's ancestors that fought in the Civil War. Also, it's made to resemble Dante from Dante's Inferno that it's based off of, and we'll talk more about that later. Turtles are made from Edelwood tree oil. This isn't so much trivia and is more of a theory. It is definitely apparent that there's a connection between the Beast, Anti-Whisper's Edelwood trees, and the black turtles we see throughout the series. The Beast needs Edelwood to stay alive. That's revealed in the final. That's just fact. We also see that the turtles have the ability to give animals qualities of the Beast, as we see Beatrice's dog in the first episode. It is heavily implied that Adelaide works for the Beast, so it could be theorized through a few clues of that her sister, Auntie Whispers, also works for the Beast due to her association and relation with Adelaide, and that her house is infested with these things like little cockroaches and her mother's prized cheesecake. Personally, I feel like the theories is kind of sort of, you know, stretching and taking certain ideas too far. I think it's definitely correct to say that the turtles are associated with the Beast, and I believe that it's also true that, you know, Adelaide is in league with the Beast. However, I don't believe that Auntie Whispers is working with the Beast or Adelaide. The show makes clear that the sisters don't have much of a relationship. It doesn't really state that they know each other that much. And I always saw the turtles as an extension of the Beast, his way of having eyes and ears in all places, you know, kind of like the devil. I never saw them as literal personifications of Edelwood, but that's just my input. Tell me what you think about that down below in the comments. Over the Garden Wall takes place in New England. I'm a broken record at this point, so here's the spiel. Over the Garden Wall is based off of old Americana and Pilgrim times, and if there's any area in, you know, America that amplifies this period, it's New England. And there's probably some video out there about McHale explaining, you know, how this was his influence, and it probably was. New England is probably the most unknown close resembled. That's pretty simple to say. Patriots, right? Dante Inferno parallels. So this one's hella dense, and probably the most interesting topic in this layer and in the series as a whole. So Dante's Inferno is a 16th century poem by Dante, the story of which has become a huge influence on public's perception of the afterlife, as well as Christian theology as a whole. It's about Dante waking up in a strange woods, and he tries to escape by descending down the 9 layers of hell with his guide Virgil, so that he can escape and find his lost love Beatrice. So immediately, based off that admittedly lame description, you could probably already see some parallels. A poet lost in the woods? That's Wirt. A guide and mention of Beatrice? That's Beatrice. Character roles are shifting around in this plot, but fundamentally, the skeleton of the Inferno is present. For example, the show's 10 episodes are meant to mimic the journey into the 9 layers of hell, the first episode being the introduction, and every episode afterward resembling one of those layers in their proper lair. Second being limbo, third being lust, fourth being gluttony. You get the idea, you know, greed, anger and sorrow, heresy, violence, fraud, and treachery. If you're looking for a more detailed overview about how these episodes fit into each layer, then you should probably go watch my video, as I go into more detail there. There's also other miscellaneous things worth mentioning, like how Wirt is based off of Dante, and both character and appearance. If you look at a picture of the two side by side, it's easy enough to guess the visual connection. As far as the character goes, they're also both poets, and both have a fragile sense of confidence, and are both prideful. Also, whilst Beatrice might sound like an obvious analog for the character of the same name found in the Inferno, the role she plays doesn't really match up with anyone aside from maybe Virgil, as they're both guides. Beatrice within Dante's Inferno is more like Sarah, ironically, as she is the object of his desires and all that. Also, the beast is the devil, but we'll get more into that later. That was a pretty long lair, and now we're halfway through this iceberg, so stick with me now. The unknown is purgatory. Over the Garden Wall is most commonly interpreted to be a story about death, which causes debate as, you know, there's many interpretations to that. Is it hell, is it a dream, or is it something else entirely? I say this, but at the end of the day, I think the unknown is purgatory. And according to Wikipedia, the definition of purgatory is the state of those who die in God's friendship, assured of the eternal salvation, but who is still in need of purification to enter the happiness of heaven. There isn't exactly a presence of God in the unknown to be in favor with, unless you want to count the Queen of Clouds, but the idea of waiting in an in-between as your soul has to be purified is something that could definitely be applied to Over the Garden Wall. As it's established in episode 9 that Warren and Greg are in between life and death, existing within a space where they must fight for the salvation of their souls. And Warren and Greg do become better people in the unknown. Wart gains more confidence and loses his pride and contempt towards Greg, and Greg learns accountability and responsibility. Their souls are purified if you subscribe to this theory, and I for one do. There's obviously more to be said about this, and for my own sanity and trying to complete this video, I'm just gonna keep this one short. You can check out my video for more explanation, and yeah. Original concept. The original story concept for Over the Garden Wall was gonna be centered around the train we see in episode 9. The train was another allegory for life and death. Wart and Greg spend the miniseries trying to get home while also trying to escape this train, knowing that the train is attempting to deliver them to death. In this concept, the beast would have actually been the train conductor, who spends the series trying to hunt down Wart and Greg and get them back on the train. In the end, the conductor gets Wart and Greg back onto the train, but it's then revealed that the train was taking them back to life, not their deaths. The concept probably wasn't used as Cartoon Network might have thought it was a little bit too dark for the channel, and wouldn't appeal that much to young viewers. And I agree with this. I think the original concept we got for the beast and the Over the Garden Wall as a whole is way better than this, and I wouldn't change it. The tavern guest, our toys come to life. I think the theory for this was made by the original iceberg creator himself, and he's made an explanation for this. So for this, I'll just be paraphrasing his words. The theory goes that the epilogue reveals that the toys put on display are actually the original form of the people in the tavern, which explains why they're all obsessed with these simplistic labels like the butcher, the tailor, the baker, and the tavern keeper, because toys have simplistic labels. This obsession and desire to conform with their labels is what keeps them confined to the unknown. This is actually a pretty good theory. It doesn't rely on too much, you know, nonsense, and it's not stretching too much. It makes complete sense as well, and is not totally out of place from what we know with the unknown. Adelwood trees are dead children. I don't know how to exactly explain this because this is kind of just obvious. It's heavily alluded throughout the show by characters such as the Woodsman and the Beast, that Adelwood trees are made by the lost souls of children who enter the unknown and have been consumed by the beast. Also, Come Wayward Souls heavily implies this. This could all be due to interpretation, but I think it's heavily implied that Adelwood trees are dead children. And also, we see this happen with Wart and Greg. When souls are lost to the unknown, they end up turning to Adelwood tree, and then they're turned into oil to, you know, fuel the lantern. Anti-Whispers created the turtles. Couldn't find much on this, so my input is limited to saying that this theory seems to be referring to the fact that Anti-Whispers' house is full of black turtles, and it's assuming that she made them. I don't think so. I still like the idea that the beast is similar to the devil, with eyes and ears everywhere, and I think that they're just equivalent to the pest around the unknown. Endicott died in Wart's hometown. In episode 9, when Wart and Greg are in the cemetery, there's a headstone visible that reads, Quincy Endicott. Same name as the eccentric and wealthy man living in the unknown. To some people, this could just be seen as an Easter egg, but if you're like me and, you know, kind of like the idea of the unknown representing some kind of afterlife, you could then say this is a little bit more than that. But that's so far with this lair. I'll be moving on to the next one now. Let's continue. Everyone has a torch to burn. If anybody watched the show, you recognize this as being one of the most noteworthy quotes from The Woodsman. When you take into account the unknown as purgatory concept, this could be interpreted as everybody has their cross or burden to bear. Or more simply, everyone has that one aspect of life they're still holding on to, so they can't pass on. For the Woodsman, it was his daughter. For Miss Langtree, it was the loss of her husband. For Auntie Whispers, it was the fear that Lorna would abandon her after not needing her anymore. It gives a lot of meaning to what people have to say. And for Wart and Greg, their torch to burn is their character issues. Wart's anxious and pessimistic, Greg's childish. And when they conquer these things, they end up leaving the unknown. The beast is a Wendigo. Some of you might not be knowing what a Wendigo is, so I'll elaborate a little bit. A Wendigo is a mythological creature belonging to Native American folklore, which is often depicted as a werewolf type of creature with large antlers coming out of their head, as it's always corrupted by hunger. They're also known to manipulate and control people to fill its own needs, and are referred to as malevolent creatures that are made of pure darkness. Compare all that to the beast, and his similarities are pretty apparent. A beast that feeds off the suffering of others? It's a more kid-friendly version, but check. Manipulating others into helping it sedate its needs? Check. Big ass antlers? Check. Being of pure darkness, it's literally covered in darkness. I mean, it definitely fits with Over the Garden Wall's frequent reinterpretation of American folklore, so yeah. I think the Wendigo is definitely an influence on the beast. But tell me what you think below in the comments if you think this is a Wendigo. Wendigoon. Iceberg. Pottsfield is a burial ground. The name of the town Pottsfield is actually a shortened version of the term Pottersfield. which is, according to Wikipedia, a place for the burial of unknown, unclaimed, or if you take the unknown as purgatory theory into account, then you could probably make a connection between the residents of Pottsfield that exist within a state of life and death, and the unknown, which sits in the same place. Also, Wirt and Greg literally dug up the graves of corpses, so it's safe to assume that this theory is correct. Winged skulls. So winged skulls are present throughout the series. We could see them on the banner of episode titles, as well on graves in Wirt and Greg's hometown. Winged skulls are common to put on gravestones in New England, as they're originally used at the 17th century grave markers. But winged skulls are symbols that represent the spiritual rebirth that one experiences in death. Since we see these symbols so often throughout the series, even on each episode title, it could be taken that Wirt and Greg are taking a spiritual journey through death throughout the series, in the unknown, which I definitely agree with as well. Okay, we have two more layers to go. Everyone in the unknown is dead. I know this is getting old again, but I'm gonna be bringing up the purgatory thing, and get used to it because I'm probably gonna bring it up a few more times. If the unknown is purgatory, or just the afterlife in general, safe to assume that everybody who inhabits is dead. Everybody's dead. Endicott's grave in episode 9 also supports this, as well as songs like Come Weary With Souls. They're either dead or settled, or they're somewhere in the in-between. Most of the people in the unknown have probably passed on, and they're waiting to either go, you know, up or down, but who knows if the up and down even exist. Maybe it's just a whole land of purgatory. It's really up to interpretation. Do you think this whole afterlife thing is true? Do you think that, you know, it was all a dream? I don't really fully know. The epilogue is heaven. I think I've referenced this theory before, and it's pretty dark if you do interpret it to be canon. You know, in the final episode where Wirt and Greg strengthen their relationship as brothers by admitting and growing their flaws? Emerging from that pond, better people with, you know, a new lease on life. Well, forget that. They're just dead. Which, I mean, it's heaven. You can't exactly say that's a bad place to end up, I guess, but it's still a little bit morbid to think that they drowned in that lake. I don't agree with this, though. I think that's a little bit too on the nose. But hey, they might be dead. I guess that's to some people's interpretation. Let me know what you think. The beast is true form. Couldn't find much information from what the beast's true form is, or what it's meant to resemble, but if you don't remember what he looks like, this is it. My personal theory is that it's a personification of all lost souls taken by the beast, all accumulated into one thing to represent the worst and most flawed parts of whomever he absorbed. The beast is a parasite who steals and manipulates and corrupts whoever he can, and I believe this appearance is made to resemble that. Or he's just made of Edel Tree made of lost souls. Either way, it's all lost souls coming to one thing. That was a pretty short layer, but now we're going into the last one. The beast is Satan. I've talked a lot about heaven, hell, religious stuff, and like I said earlier, I do think he's the equivalent of Satan. The beast is definitely a metaphor for the devil within the unknown. Like I said, he's deceitful, manipulative, and a parasite. He's also literally a being of pure darkness. It's not subtle, and it's clearly obvious. Also, if we're going off the Dante's Inferno stuff, this is also very easy to assume. Also, Satan's clearly an antagonist to, you know, most religious things. Greg has been to the unknown before. If you watch from start to finish, Greg's demeanor and feelings are strange. He doesn't seem to be afraid, he's very willing to make friends with others, and on occasion, he keeps a sense of what is dangerous in the unknown. Think about how Greg knew not to go to Auntie Whisper's house, and his caution of Lorna. He hardly even reacted when Lorna turned into a demon spirit, which would naturally scare most children. He also threw two pennies away with confidence that everything would be fine. Greg also had the ability to reach Cloud City and defeated the North Wind on his own. It could be written that Greg is just innocent and naive. However, this theory suggests that Greg has actually been to the unknown before, but he just doesn't remember it completely. Greg somehow escaped the unknown on his own and subconsciously remembers the ability to escape. This is why he's always confident, optimistic, and has a sense of danger. The reason this is a dark theory is because it would mean that Greg would have to have a near-death experience, or has previously died in the real world and was brought back. But this was all a quote from the original iceberg creator. Personally, I don't really subscribe to this theory, as I once again feel it's reaching. I personally think that Greg's carefree nature and navigation in the unknown is supposed to be a part of his character flaw, of not being able to consider the consequences or circumstances. Instead of it being a sign that he's familiar with the unknown, I think he just doesn't care that much. Well, that's the end of the iceberg. To those who watched all the way through, thank you. Like I said, if you want to watch other videos on my channel, there's a playlist in the description where you can go watch them there. Also, I recommend you watch all the other videos on my channel. Once again, if you liked it, please like the video and subscribe. With that, I'm Dr. Skipper. I'll see you in the next one. I chain smoke till I choke. Have a good heart, but bad health. You would never know. Where can you turn at the end?